So in 1797, Samuel Taylor Coleridge composed one of the most famous poems of all time. But was it all because he was on drugs? Stick around for a reading, summary, and analysis of Kubla Khan, and we'll see if we can find out. So usually I dive right into a reading, but this poem actually starts with a two-paragraph introduction about what's going on in Samuel T. Coleridge's life at this time. So rather than read those two paragraphs to you, because it is a long poem already, I'm going to summarize it. First off, he has a headache and he's prescribed an anodyne, which in this case means opium. So it is a prescription drug, but they didn't know as much about opium, I guess. It's stronger than most of what we would take for like a headache. So he's pretty doped up, is the point. Second, he is reading from a book called Purchase Pilgrims. That's the shorthand title of it. But basically, it's a travel history book about Marco Polo. Hence Kubla Khan and the setting of the poem. And then he falls asleep. And when asleep, we're told he dreams like 300 lines that he then starts composing once he wakes up. Now you'll notice the poem is not 300 lines long because he is interrupted by a person from Porlock. Stevie Smith, the poet, has strong feelings about this person from Porlock. You might too. Maybe you don't like the poem. Maybe you're happy the person from Porlock interrupted him and it's not 300 lines long, because after he's interrupted by this guy for an hour, he returns to writing, only to discover, gasp, that he's forgotten all but a few of the scattered lines of this dream, so we're left with a vision in a dream, a fragment, and that is what we read when we dive into Kubla Khan. So this is a long poem. It doesn't even fit on all the slides. I had to break it up mid-stanza from time to time. So bear with me here, because I think it's a really interesting poem and incredibly atmospheric when you read it out loud. So follow along with me. I know it's a little bit longer, but we'll dive right into it. In Xanadu did Kubla Khan a stately pleasure dome decree, where Alph, the sacred river, ran through caverns measureless to man down to a sunless sea. So twice 5 miles of fertile ground with walls and towers were gilded round, and there were gardens bright with sinuous rills where blossomed many an incense-bearing tree. And here were forests, ancient as the hills, enfolding sunny spots of greenery. But oh, that deep romantic chasm which slanted down the green hill athwart a cedarn cover, a savage place, as holy and enchanted as air beneath a waning moon was haunted by woman wailing for her demon lover. And from this chasm with ceaseless turmoil seething, as if this earth in fast thick pants were breathing, a mighty fountain momentarily was forced, amid whose half-swift intermittent bursts huge fragments vaulted like rebounding hail, or chaffy grain beneath the thresher's flail, and mid these dancing rocks at once and ever it flung up momentarily the sacred river. 5 miles meandering with a mazy motion through wood and dale the sacred river ran, then reached the caverns measureless to man and sank in tumult to a lifeless ocean. And mid this tumult Kubla heard from far ancestral voices prophesying war. The shadow of the dome of pleasure floated midway on the waves, where was heard the mingled measure from the fountain and the caves. It was a miracle of rare device, a sunny pleasure dome, with caves of ice. A damsel with a dulcimer in a vision once I saw. It was an Abyssinian maid, and on her dulcimer she played, singing of Mount Abora. Could I revive within me her symphony and song? To such deep delight 'twould win me, that with music loud and long I would build that dome in air, that sunny dome, those caves of ice, and all who heard should see them there, and all should cry, beware, beware. His flashing eyes, his floating hair. Weave a circle round him thrice, and close your eyes with holy dread, for he on honeydew hath fed, and drunk the milk of paradise. So like I said, it is quite a poem, and there is so much to dive into here, just with the sound of the poem, let alone the meaning of it. So I'm just going to hit some surface stuff, as well as some overall observations, but certainly ask me questions in the comments, or read further from what more qualified scholars have to say about this, because it's been debated for like 200 years. So let's dive into the first part. A couple words you might need to know. Xanadu, it is a specific place name, although with a different spelling. It's in the book that Coleridge was reading, but it has kind of changed meaning since this poem. Kubla Khan is also a real person. He was the grandson of Genghis Khan, but Alph is not a real river. It does, however, have metaphorical significance. What I want to point out here is what I put in green, which is that this pleasure dome that Kubla Khan decreed to be built near the sacred river is a dome of nature. And of course, nature is very important to the romantics, such as Coleridge. And in this instance, specifically, you can see almost an Eden-like situation going on here. It kind of reminds me of like the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. As we dive further into the poem, again, some words you might need to know, but I want you to look at the stuff in yellow. We have deep romantic chasm, savage place, holy, enchanted, haunted, demon lover, this chasm with the mighty fountain and the sacred river. And you can see we've shifted from the dome to the river that seemed to be just this passing reference, the river Alph. It turns out it's very important. And this underground source of the river is a highly mystical place, and it is about to come to the surface like a thresher's flail throwing the grain to separate the chaff into the air, and it bursts these huge rocks into the air, much like a geyser is what I think we would call it. And right by the dome, the river explodes out of the ground, this sacred river explodes out of the ground and starts causing havoc and throwing hail-like rocks everywhere. So what do we do with this from here? Well, all of a sudden the dome is picked up and it meanders with a mazy motion through the woods and the river down to the caverns and into the lifeless ocean. So we have a lot of water imagery here. And what you can see is that this dome is carried to the underground sea. And this results in what were called a miracle of rare device. The sunny pleasure dome underground with caves of ice. Something that should never happen. So it's rare. And this is an instance of specific beauty. And that's very important to the romantics. Byron describes a woman at a dance as walking in beauty like the night of cloudless climes and starry skies. That's not a night you see very often. Coleridge describes a girl in one of his poems as being a violet half covered by a mossy stone. So these are really specific images. They're not just like, oh, they're beautiful or whatever. They're very specific. And here we have a sunny pleasure dome in an underground sea ice cave thing. It's about as specific as you could get. Okay, so let's wrap this up now. We move into this abrupt shift with the stanza, where all of a sudden we get all this music happening. A dulcimer is an instrument, and the Abyssinian maid, which is a section of like what is now modern Ethiopia, singing of Mount Abora, which we don't even know what it's referencing. Did he make that up? Is he referring to Paradise Lost? We're unsure. But what we do know is that if he could hear this song, right, and it doesn't really flow with the poem. Remember, it's a dream, so it doesn't have to make sense necessarily. If he could hear this song, it would unlock the lost beauty from the beginning of the poem, that dome, those caves of ice. So if he could hear this song and revive it, write it down, capture it, he would unlock that rare lost beauty. And what would he do with that beauty, you might ask? Well, if anyone who sees him would have to close their eyes with holy dread, because he would have flashing eyes and floating hair. And you can see in this end of the poem here that we get some highly religious imagery here. In the Old Testament, when people looked on the face of God, they would have to close their eyes with holy, reverent dread. And the idea of honey and milk and paradise sounds a lot like the Promised Land, which was said to be a land of flowing with milk and honey. And we kind of get some more, some more mystical religion in here as well, the weaving a circle around him thrice and closing his eyes with holy dread. But it seems to me that by the end of the poem, Coleridge believes that were he able to capture his dream perfectly, build that dome, hear that song, and revive it, he would become almost godlike. Because like God, he could create perfection. He could create Eden, the garden of paradise, in a poem, in art. And this is a common idea in the Romantics. Keats says that beauty is truth, truth beauty. So beauty is everything, and capturing it is very difficult. In Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, Victor isn't an artist, he's more of a scientist, but again, he feels if he can succeed in creating this new species, it will bless him as a creator. It will turn him into God. He's stealing the fire from the gods like Prometheus, right? So all of this seems to suggest that for Coleridge, were he able to capture this whole dream, all 300 lines, he would have perfect art, something that no one but God can attain. So do drugs make for great poems? Well, not exactly. Here, the Kubla Khan commanded a palace to be built, and a stately garden thereunto, and thus 10 miles of fertile ground were enclosed with a wall. That is the line that Coleridge tells us he's reading from before he falls asleep. You'll notice that that line changes. Has a lot of the same details, but there's some specific details that change when it gets into the actual poem. So up top you have the prose, the inspiration, and plus drugs, and down below you have the poem itself. Now take a second to look at that and see if you can figure out what differences are put into the poem. Obviously, a couple words are changed, but one is like straight out totally different the way it is spoken in the poem. You can pause the video for a second if you need to. Okay, did you catch it? 10 miles of fertile ground becomes twice 5 miles of fertile ground. Why would you say twice five? If someone's like, hey, when are you going to be there? I'm never like, you know, twice 5 minutes. You would never say that. You would say 10 minutes. You would say 10 miles. But when you say twice 5 miles of fertile ground, the five and the fertile get to repeat the F sound. So you get this alliteration to it. And if you go through this poem, you will find beautiful alliteration and rhymes and rhythm all over the place. Just in here, caverns, measureless to man, sunless sea, with walls, dome decree, Kubla Khan himself. So Coleridge, and we have his manuscripts, Coleridge is kind of lying, right? He's telling a fib. He is showing us, or he's telling us that he created this just out of a vision, but we know by looking at his drafts that he handcrafted this very, very specifically and carefully. And even if you listen to Big Papa, old Ernest Hemingway there, who famously said, write drunk, edit sober, the editing, the tough part, has to come from a rational, sober brain. Also, it should be noted that we're not even sure Hemingway said that, and we're almost 100% sure that though he was an alcoholic, he did not write drunk. He did bad things, usually, when he was drunk, and he probably would have written a lot more were he not drunk so much. That tends to be the case for most great artists. The inspiration doesn't come from drugs, it comes from hard work. But there is some lasting influence with this poem, and one could even say that Coleridge might have actually done what he set out to do. If you've ever seen Citizen Kane, one of the most famous movies of all time, The Mansion is called Xanadu. If you've ever seen Bill Gates's house, don't know why you would, but if you would, if you did, his mansion in Washington is called Xanadu 2.0. And if you go to the South Pole, you might find the River Alph, the real River Alph now, next to Xanadu Hills. So even though Coleridge wasn't able to recreate that dome in the air by perfecting his poetry, filmmakers, tech inventors, and Arctic explorers all built something out of his words, created reality. Now there is a River Alph. That's pretty remarkable. So thank you guys so much for watching. I really do appreciate it. If you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the comments. I have some other videos here you might enjoy. But like I said, it's a super long poem and there's so much you can dive into. So please don't hesitate to start a conversation about it. In the meantime, go read something great. Go be inspired by Coleridge's poem. You know, go invent Microsoft, whatever you do. And thanks for watching. Have a great day. Bye.